here.
Guess what's not?
My $412 million is sitting in your account so you can pass your audit.
Take seven. Hey, Mark.
It's a fascinating story.
Arbitrage is about so many things, but I guess in large part, it's the story of a man who makes a couple of bad decisions and you sort of watch the unraveling of his life.
He's kind of a self-made guy. We chose not to play him as someone who came from this world, but someone who invented himself. A guy who's definitely an alpha personality. He's in charge. People work for him, and it's very clear.
I think what's interesting about it is you really empathize with him. Like, he's a very good person, and he loves his family.
Awesome!
But his morality unravels, and I think it's because he makes these small sort of compromises in the choices he makes.
I think there's an aspect to him, and that's part of, you know, the manipulation, the ability to control every situation.
Just find out why Mayfield hasn't called us.
How am I supposed to figure
out? Do I have to do every goddamn thing myself? Just find out, will you, please? Thank you.
It's not just because it's power, it's also, you know, force of personality, force of will, force of intelligence and wit, ability to read people in situations. And the guy's hyper successful, no question about it.
I am the Oracle of Gracie Square. You came to me, I did not come to you.
Robert, I think we're getting off on the wrong foot.
No, forget the deal. I don't even care about the deal.
He has this very picturesque life, and you get that, you know, the jet and the beautiful home and the perfect family, and then right away you're inside the sort of rotting interior of that perfect red apple.
This is a guy who has found a way of balancing everything. He's got 400 plates that he's juggling, and he's juggling them very well.
Half of the fund's assets are missing.
That's ridiculous. I mean, it can't be right.
It's ridiculous, and yet that's
okay.
What
it... Okay, look, I'll look into this. I promise you, I'll look into it.
He knows the plates. He's trained his arms and his wrists to do whatever is necessary to keep them all in the air, and I don't think he has any interest in changing that.
Hey,
may I help you?
Detective Bryan. I was helping see Mr. Miller.
Is he expecting you?
Possibly.
I've met a few of these guys. I've met a few of these. Money jugglers. It seems very real to me what he's doing. He looks like he belongs in that world, Richard. It's a very, very, very wealthy world.
All right, guys, here we go. Rehearsal's up.
I do want to help you, you know that. I got business troubles, you understand? People rely on me. Listen, I want to talk to you a second. Come here.
When I first met him, I got here for a rehearsal, and he walks over to me and he gives me this big hug and says, I'm so happy you're here. You know, for someone that's, you know, I'm up and coming young actor, he's a legend. He's one of the best.
What are you gonna do?
Right now, if I were to speak, a lot of people would get hurt. Jobs, families, a lot of innocent people. Do you think you can understand
yeah,
that?
But what about me?
He's incredibly well prepared, and he just he goes about his business.
Actors talk about this all the time, about trying to be really present. Sometimes you find when you're acting opposite a really great actor, and Richard is this way, he is so in the story that if for a moment you are thrust outside of it, like if a siren goes off, Richard is so good that he just, like, you just look at him and he, like, sucks you right back into the story. From the word go, you're racing through this story at a breakneck speed, wanting to find out what's gonna happen.
Tell me what the fuck's going on.
He's laying on the pressure, and the audience should feel that pressure.
I am your partner.
You are not my partner. You work for me.
Richard Gere's horizons are getting narrower and narrower and narrower and narrower as we go through. Hopefully the audience will feel that.